Not long after the passage of the Fugitive Slave Law, a runaway knocked on the door of a house in Brunswick, Maine. As fate would have it, he had come upon the new home of Harriet Beecher Stowe and her family, including a newborn named after the baby they had buried in Cincinnati. Stowe was well aware of the punishment facing anyone who helped a runaway, but she was glad of the opportunity to defy the government. "Before this law, I might have tried to send him somewhere else," she wrote her sister. As it was, all hands in the house united in making him up a bed. Like many Northerners, Stowe was deeply disturbed by the Fugitive Slave Law. For her, its cruelty was all too real. Every account of flight, of capture, tore at the agonizing memory of Charlie's death.
"My heart breaks at the cruelty and injustice our nation inflicts on the slave. I am tormented by the thought of the slave mothers whose babes are torn from them. I pray to God to let me do a little and to cause my cry for them to be heard."
Leaving Cincinnati allowed Harriet to look back at those 18 years there and to process that experience of the slave riots, Charlie's death, the Fugitive Slave Law, and it all came together in a vision. Instead of Christ on the cross, she saw an image of a slave being whipped. And she wrote the ending of Uncle Tom's Cabin when Uncle Tom dies. And when she read it to her family, they were all crying and they said, "Mama, you've got to write the rest of the story."
On March 20th, 1852, a publisher released a book on a difficult subject by an unknown author. By the end of the week, Harriet Beecher Stowe's novel about the evils of slavery had sold 10,000 copies. Within 2 months, 50,000. Three paper mills feeding three printing presses running 24 hours a day, and still the publisher couldn't keep up. Soon, Uncle Tom's Cabin began reaching vast new audiences, including many who had never read a novel when it was adapted as a wildly popular play.